Hello students, now dear my student, this is our first class. Let me first introduce myself, Dr. Himani Pandurnekar. I am the faculty of G.H. Rai Soni Academy of Engineering and Technology. My subject is chemistry. As this is your first class, now students tell me why you people are learning that basic science subjects is in the engineering curriculum. The foundation of the engineering is laid down by the in the first year engineering. Subjects taught in the first year engineering are the foundation subjects, or you can say that it is the basic subjects. The basic subjects which you taught in the first year engineering are applied sciences, engineering chemistry, or engineering drawing, engineering graphics, or engineering mechanics. The basic subjects is which we taught, that chemistry, physics, and mathematics department. My dear students, as it is a compulsory that you have to learn engineering chemistry in the first semester, and as you have to learn that material chemistry in the second semester. Today in our session, I will tell you about the syllabus of material chemistry, which is your in the second semester curriculum. And now I will discuss and describe the syllabus, the some points of the syllabus, that is in the of the first unit. Now in first unit, or we first of all we can take a that is a look how many units we have, that is 4 units in the subject material chemistry. In the first unit we have, that is the first unit or second unit, both are related to the topic energies, and third unit, it is related to the topic lubricants and its mechanism processes. Unit number 4 is related with the advanced material. Now my dear students, I have to tell one thing, that you took the admission in engineering, so as we are learning the basic subject, my subject is chemistry, means that this is your chemistry class. Then the what is the relevancy between the chemistry and the engineering? So let me tell you now that the curriculum, or we can say the syllabus of the engineering which we are learning right now, or which we are going to learn in the future classes or the our session, that the having some relevance with the engineering, that is the topics or whatever the concepts, it is having relevance with the engineering, as they are directly or indirectly used in the concept of, that is the engineering, that they have some industrial applications. So this is a one, that is a outlook, that key why we are learning the subject, the engineering chemistry in the first semester, and that is the material chemistry in the second semester. Now we will start with the our unit, that is, as I already told, that in we have, that is the unit 1, unit 2. As I already told that we have 4 units, so unit 1, unit 2, unit 3, then unit 4. Now as I already told that unit 1 and unit 2, it belongs to the topic, that is energy. And it is named as energy 1 and energy 2. Now unit 3 is, that is lubrication, and the unit 4 is advanced material. Okay, these are the names of the unit. Now as I told that we will today in our class we are going to discuss, that is the unit 1 or some of the topics of the unit 1 and unit 2. Now the first topic of our unit 1, energy 1, is, that is the fuels. Now my dear students, tell me what is fuels, or what is the definition of the fuels. Now what are the application of the fuel, how it is important to us, or for our domestic or as well as the industrial applications or uses. Now as what is fuel, then define any the fuel. So what are the fuels? Fuels are nothing but the substance or the material which having, that is, the property of a combustion. Means property of combustion means when it react with the oxygen, then it show that by the reaction of the oxygen, it will show the reaction that it is undergo the process of reaction known as oxidation. It is ultimately oxidation reaction and it forming, that is, the high amount of energy. That's why this unit having the name energy one. No doubt the contents are the fuel. We have to study all about the fuel in both the unit 1 and 2, but as the name relevance is along with the topic is, that is, the fuels is nothing but the substance or the material which on combustion produces energy. Because of that reason, this name of the top units are as relevant with the topic energy. Now, as I said, fuels is the materials or the substances which on combustion liberate energy. Now, tell me, what are the chemical composition of the fuel? What is the chemical composition of fuel? What are the chemical composition of the fuels, my dear students? The chemical composition of the fuel is nothing but it having the presence of, that is, the most important, that is, the carbon and the hydrogen, okay, along with the sulfur, nitrogen and oxygen in process. As I said, what is the chemical composition of the fuel is, that is, the carbon, hydrogen and sulfur and nitrogen and oxygen in traces. That material is, that is, nothing but the fuel. Okay, as I said, this is nothing but the fuel. Now, what are the classification of the fuel? As we know right now, I already told he what is the fuel, what its chemical composition, what its, that is, the that function, what for what purpose it is used. Okay, now after that, classification of the fuels. The classification of the fuel is on some parameters, means that is the classification of the fuel is done on some particular characteristic features or parameters. Now, what are they? The first parameter of the fuel on which it get classified, that is occurrence. And second is, that is, it get classified on the basis of, that is, the physical texture of the fuel. Now, as I told that key, the classification of the fuel, then I already told that on which basis the classification is done, that is on the basis of the two parameters, occurrence and second one is the physical texture. Now, we will say now what is that the classes. On the basis of the occurrence, the fuels can be classified broadly into two types, or we can say that the two classes, okay. On the basis of occurrence means from where it get originated, that is, on the basis of, that is, the occurrence, the first class of the fuel is primary fuel, okay. Then on the basis of the, that is, the occurrence, the fuel is again having the second class, which is known as the secondary class of the fuel. Okay, now we will discuss on that, that is, ki how they classified on this basis occurrence. Okay, now on the basis of occurrence means how we get these fuels. Okay, now the first is class is which, that is, the primary fuels, and the second is known as secondary fuels, and that secondary fuels can be also known as the derived fuels. Now, first, primary fuels, that is, primary fuels, the name is given that the fuels, they occur naturally. What I said, that they occur naturally, okay, that's why they having the name, that is, the primary fuels. And second one is, that is known as, this class is known as secondary fuels. And that why they are called as secondary fuels or derived fuels, because that fuels can be formed or modified by just modification of the crude fuels or the primary fuels. That's why they are known as that is the secondary fuels or that is the derived fuels. Okay. Now, as I already told that they are classified in on two parameters. So, first parameter is occurrence. Now what is this next is physical texture. Okay. So, fuels first they get divided into two classes, that is on the basis of occurrence, primary and secondary. Now, this primary and secondary fuels, they classified into three sub classes. Okay. And that three sub classes in on the basis of these physical texture. Okay. Now, what are they? That is the first of that is the primary or the natural class. It is a solid fuel. Okay. The second is that is the liquid fuel, and the third one is the gaseous fuel. Okay. Means these two classes, primary and secondary, which form on the occurrence, on the basis of occurrence, they classified into three subclasses, means again that is the solid, liquid and gaseous, and these three classes is same in primary as well as the secondary. Okay. Now, what is the example of the solid primary fuel? That solid primary fuel, the example is coal. Okay. And that the liquid primary fuel is what? It is nothing but that is the vegetable or animal oil, and that is the third one is that is the primary naturally that the third class of the fuel is gaseous fuel, and the example is that is the natural gases. Now, in such a manner that the secondary fuel is also having the three classes, that is solid, then liquid, then the gaseous. Okay. They also having these three subclasses, which is nothing but on the basis of physical texture. Now, the example of that particular solid and liquid fuel and gaseous fuel in the second class, secondary or derived. So, that the solid fuel is nothing but that is our charcoal, nitrocellulose, nitroglycerin. These are the different example of the solid fuels. Okay. Now, my dear student, what is that is in the example in the liquid class? That is in the liquid class, the fuel are nothing but the petrol and the diesel, the most that the demanding fuel of today's time that we require the human beings. Okay. Now, the second that is the gaseous fuel, and the example in the secondary gaseous fuel is nothing but our LPG, CNG, water gas. These are the different gaseous fuel which is placed in that is the gaseous secondary or the derived class. Okay. Now, this is all about the classification of the fuel. Now, my dear students, we have that as I already right now told that these are the classes. Okay. So, as I told that how many types of the fuels are occur there as on the basis of physical texture, that is solid, liquid and gaseous. Now, okay. Now, as I told that if fuel is nothing but the material which is used, that is which is used, or we can say it is nothing but the material on which combustion liberated energy. Now, my dear student, as we are saying ki we are using this material as a fuel. So, where we are using in the industries, in the domestic purposes, and the most important that is our vehicles and all. So, that is in the engines. So, as we are using this fuel, so there are some properties. Okay. There are some properties, my dear students, that has to be checked out by the that is the company or whatever the that. Okay. So that what are that properties or what that properties are saying? That properties are nothing but that is some of the physical chemical properties of the fuels. Okay. And the first and the most important is nothing but that is the calorific value. Okay. What is that, my dear student? That is nothing but the calorific value. What I said right now? It is known as calorific value. Now, tell me, student, what is calorific value? what is the definition of the calorific value, and then now tell me what is the reason that we have to check out that. Why we have to check out this property? Why we have to find out ki how much calorific value is going to be given by the material which we are using as a fuel? So my answer is that for this, that is ki as we are using this material as a fuel, so we should know ki how much amount of energy it is going to be liberated. As we are saying ki that these are the number of fuels, and we are using, we have different example of the fuels, but every fuel is not of higher quality or not of that much ki that all are giving a very good energy, na? So that's why we have to find out some properties. Okay, so first what I told, that is the calorific value. Okay, now what is calorific value? Now the question is what is calorific value? So calorific value is what? It is nothing but the property of the fuel which gives the idea about the efficiency of the fuel, that how much amount of energy is going to be liberated or produced after the complete combustion of a fuel. Okay, that is the calorific value. Understand or not? Okay, theek hai. Now let me again tell that ki what is that exactly. Now again I will explain what is it. Calorific value is what? It is the property of fuel which gives idea about the efficiency of the fuel, that how much amount of energy is going to be produced after the combustion of fuel. That is known as calorific value. Okay, and now this is a general thing that ki it is the property. Okay, now exact definition of the calorific value is what? That the calorific value can be defined as the amount of heat obtained or liberated after the complete combustion of unit mass of solid or liquid or unit volume of the gaseous fuel. Okay, at STP, same temperature and pressure conditions, that is nothing but the calorific value of a fuel. Okay, what is that? Ki how much amount of energy is liberating after its complete combustion. Okay, and as a standard wise, we are preparing the definition just like ki how much amount of energy liberating after the complete combustion of unit mass of solid or liquid fuel or unit volume of gaseous fuel at STP is known as calorific value. Okay, now what is the unit of the calorific value? Unit of the calorific value is calorie per gram, or that is kilocalorie per kg. Okay, these are the two units which are generally used. Okay, that calorie per gram or kilocalorie per kg. Okay, now as I told, this is one of the, that is the physicochemical property of the fuel. Okay, as that the fuel having high calorific value, then and then only it is a very good fuel. Okay, now it again divided into two types, that what are that? That is G's gross calorific value. Okay, and it is also representing as GCV, gross calorific value, and second is, that is NCV, means net calorific value. Okay, now what is GCV and what is NCV? Means what is gross calorific value and what is net calorific value? Now the definition of the gross calorific value, my dear students, is what? That gross calorific value of a fuel can be defined as the amount of energy or heat obtained on complete combustion of unit mass of solid fuel or unit volume of gaseous fuel at STP, and the product of combustion on cooling to 15 degree Celsius, that is known as the gross calorific value. Okay, and it is representing by GCV, and that GCV, that gross calorific value, is also known as is also known as, that is the higher calorific value. Okay. Now, what is NCV? NCV is what? The full form of the NCV is net calorific value. Net calorific value of a fuel can be defined as the amount of heat or energy obtained on complete combustion of unit mass of solid or liquid fuel or unit volume of gaseous fuel at STP, and the product of combustion are allowed to, that is, to escape out with some heat. What is, and the product of combustion are allowed to escape with some heat. That is known as NCV, that is net calorific value. Okay, its representation is just by NCV. Now, after this, that is the GCV and NCV. Now, what is the relation between the GCV and the NCV? Okay, GCV. Okay, that GCV is what? GCV is nothing but it is the related with NCV like this. GCV equals to NCV plus 9 into H into latent heat of water, okay, then divided by 100. This is the, that is the relation between GCV and NCV. What is that? GCV equals to NCV plus 9 into H into latent heat of water divided by 100. That's why I said GCV is also known as, that is, higher calorific value. It is nothing but the sum of NCV plus the sum heat which is going to be generated by the condensation of the water molecules, or and that water molecules is came from where? That is when we come, when we perform, that is the reaction of combustion of fuel. Then when the fuel is undergo the combustion, that fuel is what? It is nothing but, that is, I told that the fuel is nothing but carbon and hydrogen. Okay, then when it burns, then carbon get burn, it releases energy plus CO2. Okay, and when hydrogen burns, then it liberates energy, and that along with that H2O, which is liberating over there in the form of, that is, the vapors, steams. And you, I think you people know that ki when water is in vapor form, so it is when it goes to vapor form, when it absorbs some energy and then it changes state from, that is, liquid to, that is, the gaseous. Because you people know that, na? Everybody knows that ki that water, the original texture or state of the water is what? Liquid. So when it changes state from water liquid to, that is, the gaseous, means it absorbs some energy and it shifted to the vapor. And okay, and when the fuel is burning, na, so that hydrogen liberates what? Energy plus H2O molecule in the vapor form. Okay, and but after some time, after the combustion process end, that H2O, which is in the vapor, it is along with the decrease in the temperature, it is now going to condense. And when it goes to condense, the condensation is take place when it goes to condense with a decrease in the temperature, means it again, it is coming to its original form, that is the liquid. Okay, and when it shifted again gaseous to liquid, it releases some energy, and that is known as the latent heat of water. And because of that reason, the relation between GCV and NCV is like that. GCV equals to NCV plus, that is, 9 into hydrogen into latent heat of water divided by 100. Okay, H stand for the percentage of hydrogen. Okay, so this is all about the relation between GCV and NCV. Okay, now as I told ki GCV or that is calorific value. Okay, calorific value is one of the, that is, the important property, physico-chemical property of the fuel. Okay, now This is the relation between GCV and NCV. Okay, now I already told what is calorific value, what is GCV and what is NCV. Now, my dear student told me how the industry people or whatever the things where the calorific value is going to be find out. Okay, so what they people are doing to find out the calorific value, what they are perform, what experiment they perform. Okay, so for the determination of the calorific value, we have that is some instrument with us. Okay, and in our syllabus, that in the unit number one, that is the energy one, we have to learn that the determination of the calorific values. Okay, so first is what, that is we have the three type of the fuels, solid, liquid and gaseous. So first, that is the determination of the solid fuel or the non-volatile liquid fuel can be done with the help of, that is our instrument number first. Which is that instrument? Anybody knows that? Okay, now let me tell you. What is that? That the name of the instrument is bomb calorimeter. What is that? It is known as the bomb calorimeter, means the instruments that which we are using for the determination or the analysis of the calorific value is nothing but the calorimeters. Okay, that the first one is which? Bomb calorimeter. Okay, now what is the second one? Second is nothing but known as the Boyle's calorimeter. Okay, what is that? Boyle's calorimeter. Okay, now tell me that what is the function of, for which type of the fuel we are using the Boyle's calorimeter. Okay, now the Boyle's with the help of the Boyle's calorimeter, we are able to determine the calorific value of gaseous fuel and highly volatile fuel. Okay, now as I already told, bomb calorimeter is used for what? Determination of solid fuel or that is non-volatile liquid fuel. Okay, now Boyle's calorimeter is used for, that is what? Boyle's calorimeter is used to determine the calorific value of gaseous fuel as well as volatile liquid fuels. Okay, so these are the two instruments which we are using for the determination of calorific value. Okay, now after that, what is in our syllabus? That is the next point, that is which we have to study after this calorimeters. What is that? That we have to study that solid fuels. Solid fuels. Okay, now my dear students, now tell me, what is solid fuels? What are the best example of the solid fuels? Okay, so coal is the best example of the solid fuel. Okay, solid fuel, that is the most important fuel which we are using as a solid fuel is what? It is nothing but the coal, I suppose. Okay, now my dear students, now tell me, from where we are getting the coal actually? What I said as we are using which that the solid fuel, that is which we are using as a fuel, that is coal. Now tell me, from where we are getting the coal, or in another word, that is what is the source from where we are getting the coal? That the coal is nothing but we are getting from, that is below our earth surface, that is earth crust. Okay, that coal is, that is also known as the fossil fuel. Okay, that the fossil fuel. Okay, what that? That is the fossil fuel. Now, why it is known as fossil fuels? What I ask? Why coal is known as fossil fuels. So that the answer of that is the coal is naturally, is that no doubt, naturally it is occurring from the earth crust, that is below the earth surface. So why it is known as fossil fuel? Fossil fuel, okay, that the history behind that is the coal is obtained before so many years, okay, that that is not in our syllabus, but that is, let me now tell you the history, that the a little bit of that, that key how the that we that coal is getting with us, that in natu- with us, which is given by our nature, okay, before so many years, some disaster or that such type of things happened in, that is the nature in our planet, okay, so that the coal is nothing but that is obtained by the debris, or we can see that is the waste of animal or vegetable dead remains, okay, and below that earth surface they get deposited, and because of that the chemical transformations, okay, chemical transformations that occur in that such type of the anaerobic conditions in presence of some microorganism or we can say bacteria, whatever it may be, the temperature condition or the pressure condition, that such type of the material is going to be occur, which is known as coal, okay. Now, as right now I told that key calorific value of the coal is going to be determined by using the bomb calorimeter. Now, the other parameters are what? That on which basis we are going to conclude that coal is our, that is the good fuel, okay. So the parameters or that to determine the parameters we require some analysis method. So what are that analysis method? So first is that is R, that is the proximate analysis. What is it says? That is proximate analysis. The second is that is ultimate analysis, okay. Now tell me, what is proximate analysis, what is ultimate analysis, okay. As I said, along with the, that is the calorific value, okay, along with the calorific value we have to also find out some another parameters, okay. By calorific value we can understand ki how much amount of energy is going to be produced by the coal, okay. Now what are the another parameters that we have to find out, that some of the parameters that of the which having the coal, that we can determine by using these two methods, that is the proximate analysis and ultimate analysis, okay. Now proximate analysis is what? It is the analysis in which we are going to determine that how much percentage of volatile matter, ash matter and moisture present in the coal. That is the proximate analysis, okay. Now what is ultimate analysis? Ultimate analysis is what? It is the analysis in which we are going to find out the percentage of carbon, hydrogen, sulfur, nitrogen and oxygen, because on the basis of this findings we are able to conclude that whether the coal is of good quality or whether it is not of good quality, okay. Though then how that the parameter should be to conclude in that whether it is good or whether it is not good, okay. So talking about proximate, that what is that proximate is nothing but the percent of moisture, volatile and ash content. So to conclude a good quality of coal, the percentage of moisture, the percentage of the ash and the percentage of that is the volatile matter should be less. What is that? What I said, that it should be less in the coal, then that the coal is of the good quality of the coal, okay. That all these parameters should be less, because that is not good, as they will present in more percent, then it will affect the calorific value. So what is that? That the percentage of moisture, volatile matter and ash content should be less, very less, okay. And then that coal is of good quality of goal. Okay. Now, what is ultimate analysis? Ultimate analysis, what I told, that it is the analysis in which we are going to that the find the percentage of carbon, hydrogen, sulfur, nitrogen and oxygen. Okay. It we can also say that it is nothing but that is the elemental analysis. What I said? It is the nothing but the elemental analysis of the coal, because in that we have to find out that is the percentage of carbon, percentage of hydrogen, percentage of sulfur, percentage of nitrogen. Okay. Now, what is the significance that why we are doing that, and what will happen? What will happen if some percentage are more or less of this element? So, what will happen with the coal? Now, let me tell you that the carbon. Okay, now the carbon should be present in a more percentage in the coal. As the more percentage of the carbon is present, it means that it conclude that it is of a good quality of the coal. Okay, now what about the hydrogen? Hydrogen should be less, because it is nothing but if hydrogen is more, means that the coal is having high moisture. So that for a good quality of coal, what will be the percentage of hydrogen? The percentage of hydrogen should be less. Okay. Now what about the sulfur? Now the sulfur, if you are talking about the sulfur, that sulfur is no doubt it is going to be contribute to the calorific value. Okay. What I said, if it is present, then it is going to be contribute to the calorific value of a coal. But what is that why we don't want that sulfur? Because no doubt it is going to contribute to the that calorific value, but when it shows combustion, it releases SO2. Okay, and with the formation of the SO2, it is one of the dangerous pollutant. So we don't want sulfur. Okay, sulfur is it should be less. Okay. Now, what about nitrogen and oxygen? Nitrogen should be less because an inert gas. So, it doesn't matter. We don't require nitrogen because it is not going to be burned at a normal condition. That's why it is known as inert gas. Okay. Now, what about oxygen? We don't want oxygen. Means presence of oxygen is what? Presence of oxygen means nothing but it is the presence of moisture. So, we don't want that oxygen at all. Okay. So, this is all about that the students about that the proximate analysis and ultimate analysis. Okay. And what I told right now, that all come under that is the significance of these analysis. Okay, my dear students, where we are, that is now that this is all about proximate and ultimate analysis. Now, my dear student, in this lecture we will finish with this proximate and ultimate analysis. Now, in the next class we will see that what are the non-conventional fuels. Okay, then now in the next class we will go through the non-conventional energy sources. Okay, my dear students, now thank you. Okay.